Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. My dear sisters, as we prepare our heart and mind to listen to the Word of God, let us all give our whole self, all that we are and all that we have. And let us all ask the Spirit of God to come and fill our hearts. And as the Word of God tells us, in the book of Psalms, chapter 150, verse 6, it says, "Let everything that has breath praise the Lord." Hallelujah! Hallelujah! And as we sing the song with our whole heart, with our whole mind, and with our whole strength, let us all sing together and worship our God. Step down into darkness, open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you, hope of my life spent with you. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. He's the King of all days. And we sing together wherever we are. Let us all give our whole heart to Jesus and we sing together.
King of all days, so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all full of sake became poor.
And we sing together.
Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Let me sing together.
Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Let me sing once again.
Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Altogether wonderful to me.
Wherever we are, let us all praise our God with all our heart, with all our strength, with all our mind. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise. We praise you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
We praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Praise.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We praise you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. We praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Praise you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Jesus.
In this hour, we come to Jesus with the prayer of the disciples. Lord, teach us to pray. Jesus, you have called us to be with you always, to remain with you. united with you. Lord, we need to learn to pray. We need to learn to abide in you, to remain with you. We do not know how to pray and what to pray for. Send us your Spirit. Your Spirit dwelling in our hearts may teach us to pray, that we may always be one with you, never alone by ourselves. At every moment, we may be able to feel your presence with us. Let us pray, waiting for the Holy Spirit to descend into our hearts, that we may experience a fresh anointing of the Spirit in our hearts.
Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Melt us, mold us, fill us.
Of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
My dear sisters, in this hour, the Lord is asking us, each one of us, a question. Mark chapter 14, verse 37. Could you not keep watch 1 hour with me? Could you not keep watch 1 hour with me? The question Jesus asked in Gethsemane. He was in agony. The cross appeared before him, threatening to destroy him. He was trembling and he fell on the rock, sweating blood. And he got up, went to the disciples, Simon Peter, John, and James, the favorite group of the disciples, and asked, could you not watch 1 hour with me? You know, my dear sisters, I believe the whole nature of prayer is given to us in this one question. What is prayer? Prayer is keeping watch with Jesus. Who is Jesus? Jesus is God with us. He's Emmanuel, God with us. What does it mean, God with us? When two pillows are kept together, we would not say one pillow is with another pillow. No, no. One pillow is on top of the other pillow. One pillow is near the other pillow. We would not say one pillow is with the other pillow. God with us. That rich word with. God with us means God sharing our life. But St. John said he pitched his tent with us. God's not far away from us. He's so close to us, so one with us. And that is the option he made in incarnation. At every moment of sorrow, he is with us. Not an indifferent spectator. No, he's with us sharing that sorrow. At every moment of success, he's with us. He's with us, rejoicing with us. At every moment of trouble, he's with us, taking that trouble into his heart in order to comfort us. That's what Jesus is. God with us. Martha and Mary felt it when they saw tears in the eyes of Jesus in Bethany, sharing their grief. Simon Peter felt it after Simon denied Jesus. We're told by Luke, Jesus turned and looked at Simon Peter. Peter saw tears in the eyes of Jesus, sharing his guilt, his shame, his embarrassment, telling him, "Don't worry, I understand you." Luke chapter 10, the disciples felt it. The master was with them. They came back after their missionary journey, sharing with Jesus all their success and all the joy of it. And the Lord began to pray with them, praising the Father. All the joy he felt in his heart. And the Lord continues to be with us. The Spirit of Jesus, the Holy Spirit with us, within us, part of us, making us part of him in every experience. At no moment of our life is our God far away from us. And what Jesus asked the three disciples, "Could you not keep watch 1 hour with me?" Keep watch with him. Remaining with him. A better translation. That's what Jesus said in the Gospel of John chapter 15, verses 1 onwards. Remain with me. Abide in me as I abide in you. The Lord abides in us, sharing every trouble, every moment of guilt, every moment of sorrow and sadness. The Lord is with us. And what is prayer? Prayer is keeping watch with Jesus who is with us. And that's what prayer is. Jesus asked Simon Peter, "Peter, what's happening? Look into the convents of the world. All the sisters are sleeping.
during prayer, the dozing off, Simon Peter, with a sheepish grin, replied, "Lord, you know the weak stuff we are made of. We are weak. And therefore, St. Paul is telling us, Romans chapter 8, verses 26 and 27. In the same way, the Spirit too comes to aid the aid of our weakness. Yes, the Holy Spirit comes to aid our weakness. For we do not know how to pray as we ought, but the Spirit itself intercedes with inexpressible groans. And the one who searches hearts knows what is the intention of the Spirit, because it intercedes for the holy ones according to God's will." The Holy Spirit intercedes with the holy ones, with those who are surrendered to Him, you and I, the holy ones, according to God's will. God wanted the Holy Spirit to intercede for us, with us. A sister once told me, "Father, I am preparing myself to celebrate the jubilee of my profession. I feel very embarrassed, Father. I do not know how to pray." I told her, "Sister, I have celebrated the jubilee of my priestly ordination. Still, I do not know how to pray." And St. Paul says he also does not know how to pray. We do not know. We do not know how to pray as we ought. As we ought. What should be our prayer? It's not we who pray. Prayer is not my doing. It's the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Jesus given to us, dwelling in our hearts, who prays. With inexpressible groans, he prays, he intercedes. Groan means what? A groan is an expression of pain, of sorrow, of embarrassment, of annoyance, of strain. A groan. There are groans deep in our hearts. Remember, he said later, the Spirit searches. The one who searches hearts, the one who searches hearts, the Holy Spirit searches our hearts, and the Holy Spirit sees the groans remaining unexpressed, inexpressible groans, unexpressed. In the depth of our hearts, there are groans unexpressed, disturbing us. How do these groans come to the depth of our hearts? Because of the many things that happen to us. We are hurt. We are annoyed. We fail. We succeed. Every such experience leaves a groan in our hearts. You know what we do usually? These experiences, we do not express it to anyone, not even to God. And all these inexpressible groans remain in our hearts. Say, for example, I failed. When I fail, I am embarrassed, but I cannot tell it to anyone. So what do? We gulp it down. Everything gulped down remains in the depths of our heart. I committed sin. Of course, I went to confess, but there is a guilt, the shame of it. I do not make that sin a moment of prayer, and therefore that guilt and shame go deep to remain in my heart. Or someone hurts me. That hurt feeling, I can't tell anyone. I don't want to be small before anyone. I can take it, I would say. Who can take it anyway? I keep it. It all is gulped down, pushed down to the depths of our heart. And every such groan remaining in our hearts will poison our lives, will mold our character as a negative character. If there's a hurt, I keep in my heart, slowly I will begin to feel a hatred brewing in my heart to that person. If I'm embarrassed because of a failure, I will not go that way anymore. If I feel guilty and I keep that guilt in my heart, slowly I would develop a distance from God. Every guilty person, if that person did not offer that guilt to God and experience tangibly the depth of God's forgiveness, that guilt will bring in a fear of punishment, and I will keep away from God, from the punishing God. All these negative experiences or even positive experiences, say for example, someone, I succeeded. I fared very well. I'm so happy. But no one came to share that happiness, to congratulate me and to rejoice with me. That success itself becomes a groan in my heart. It is these inexpressible groans that pop up when I sit to pray. When I sit to pray, meditate these groans, the sadness, the embarrassment, that hurt feeling, that strain in my job, all these will pop up. And what do we call it? We call it distractions, right? Distractions in prayer. And we will go and confess, Father, I was distracted in prayer. Really, my dear sisters, are these distractions? Distraction means what? Something strange to me. Something distracting me. Something that's not mine. But really, these, what we call distractions, are what I am. What I am. My sadness, my sorrow, my strain, my hurt. This is what I am. And we cover it all up as we wear the Sunday best when we come to church. We cover it all up and begin to meditate. Zacchaeus climbing up the sycamore tree. But before Zacchaeus reaches up there, I'm somewhere else, Amidai. That's what happened to me. In the minor seminary, I was taught to pray. At home, I prayed fairly well. But when I was taught to pray, I failed to pray. Because prayer is taught systematically. And prayer is not to be systematized. Because prayer is the most spontaneous expression of my relationship with my God. Because before Zacchaeus reaches on top of sycamore tree. I'm in the basketball court. Yesterday, during the game, I hardly got any ball passed to me. I was a small fellow then. Most of my companions were tall, sturdy people. I felt neglected. I'm very good at shooting. If I got a ball, I would make it a point, putting it straight. I hardly got a ball. I feel neglected. I feel small. And when I sit to pray, that sadness, that anger, that hurt feeling would come up in my mind. I called it distraction. Is that distraction? That is what I am. I'm hurt. I'm embarrassed. I'm made to feel good for nothing. That's what I am. And slowly, I began to feel that God has called me. But God has called me as I am. As I am. With all my weaknesses, with all my problems, with all my hurts, and therefore, my God is interested in me. He's interested to know what I am, whatever that is. I also came to know my God shares that embarrassment, that hurt, that sorrow. I began to tell my God, that's what happened. That's what happened. In the basketball court, I'm hurt. I don't want to go to play anymore in that court. I would take some excuse and go somewhere else. I would say to my Lord, that is what I feel. That's what I feel. I began to feel my God sharing my embarrassment. My God with me. My God who loves me. What do I mean? My God loves me. He shares my life. He's Emmanuel. He shares all my sadness, all my sorrow, all my guilt, all my embarrassment. I realized this is what I must offer to my God. You know, my dear sisters, how is it and why is it our prayer becomes a mere ritual? We repeat formulae that do not touch us anymore. I go to pray, I come back from prayer feeling empty again. You know, in the Serum Malabar Holy Mass, there's a final prayer. There are 10 priests, 5 priests, concelebrating. At the end of it, the final prayer, I do not know whether I will come again to offer sacrifice. One priest once said, I do not know whether I prayed at all. Was I in that prayer? There's something beautiful that I found in the Gospels. The way Jesus prayed, the way Jesus prayed. Let me read for you Luke chapter 11, verses 1 onwards. Jesus was praying in a certain place. And when he had finished, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples. You can imagine that scene on a hillside, Jesus praying, and all the disciples looking at him, edified. That grace on his face when the master was praying, the joy filling his heart, showing on his face the delight expressed. And the disciples thought, we need to pray like this. And they asked him, Master, teach us to pray. Saint Augustine becomes very eloquent when he interprets this particular passage. Saint Augustine tells us, the disciples had seen many things Jesus did. Again and again, the Gospels tell us, the disciples were astounded, astonished, wonderstruck at the great miracles Jesus performed. At the way Jesus silenced the scribes and the Pharisees in argument. And the marvelous teachings that Jesus gave. They were astounded. And yet, not once did the disciples go to Jesus to tell him, to ask him, Master, tell us that technique. When you raise the hand, the storm subsides and the waves fall back into the water. What is the magic of it? How can you defeat the Pharisees and scribes so efficiently? No. The disciples did not ask any such thing to the Lord. The one thing they wanted to do as Jesus did was to pray. As the master prayed, and St. Augustine is asking why? Because one thing the disciples understood. The master was a man of prayer. If we could pray as the master prayed, everything else will follow. Everything else. We will be able to teach as he taught. We will be able to do miracles. We will be able to heal. But one thing, we need to be like the master. Being like the master is by learning to pray as the master prayed. Many sisters, what are we trained for? You know, this formation time, after formation time, again we go for training, computer training, education training, nurses training. What are we trained for? If I'm not formed, trained to pray, I will be a failure. In my consecration, in my ministry, I used to tell myself, if people do not come to me to ask me, Father, teach us to pray as you pray. If people do not come to ask me that question, my priesthood is a failure. I could work wonders. I could teach efficiently. I could preach wonderfully. And yet, it's not what I am. It's not what I am. I should be a man of prayer. And the prayer of Jesus. The Gospels tell us beautifully how great a man of prayer Jesus was. John chapter 6, verse 12. Jesus went into a lonely place and prayed the whole night. Mark chapter 1, verse 35. Early morning he rose and went to a lonely place to pray. Mark chapter 1, verse 36. Peter woke up late. Remember in Capernaum, Jesus was in the house of Simon Peter. Peter woke up late and the people were crowding around. The master was not there. And Peter knew, where would the master be? He will be in that lonely place he used to choose to pray in. I, a priest, you, a sister, if you're not found anywhere by your students you teach, the patients you care for, your sisters, you're not found anywhere, would they think, she must be in the chapel praying? That's where we should be. That's where we should be. Luke chapter 5, verse 16. He withdrew to a lonely place to pray. And there's a background to that. Jesus cleansed a leper. You know, in those days, leprosy was considered a shame, a destiny, and a curse. It's a curse of God that brings in leprosy. So nobody cared for lepers. They have to suffer. They suffer, they're paying for their sinfulness. Cursed by God, but Jesus healed a leper. Leprosy was considered incurable. And his fame began to spread all over. The next sentence, Luke chapter 5, verse 16, he withdrew to a lonely place to pray. Peter would have wanted to erect a podium to convene a meeting to congratulate. No. He went to a lonely place to put that success in my ministry. I need to share with my father who sent me. Share it with the father whom Jesus knew. My father is always with me. Again, Luke chapter 6, verse 12. He went to a lonely place to pray. And the background is very noteworthy. In the synagogue on a Sabbath day, Jesus healed a man with a withered hand. And the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the Herodians were enraged. Sabbath? You cannot heal. Doctors were not allowed to heal on Sabbath. Breaking of Sabbath. And we are told, the Herodians and the Pharisees were religious leaders. Herodians were the political powers in those days and even now. When religious and secular powers, leaders come together, they could achieve anything. They plotted against Jesus. What a terrible misunderstanding. Jesus gave a man a future, a life. What does it mean? The hand is not okay. Withered hand, a withered future, a withered life. He could not marry, he could not raise a family, he could not work. A man, empty life. Jesus gave him a future, and that was misunderstood as the breaking of the law of Sabbath, the highest law among the Jews. And they began to plot against Jesus. The first plot against Jesus. He was sad. A sorrow of being misunderstood. The misunderstanding will spread among the people that he did not care for the law of the Father. All that sorrow, he went to a lonely place to share with the Abba, with the Father. Mark chapter 6, verses 31 onwards. A very busy day. Very busy day. Teaching for a long time and feeding a large crowd. A busy day. At the end of it, he went to a lonely place to pray. You know, my dear sisters, all of us are very busy people. But there is a warning given by Pope John Paul II. A busy life is a barren life. Barren means what? Unproductive, infertile, dry. Is my life dry? I don't produce anything anymore. When I speak to others, they're not able to feel with me. When I do something, the result comes. Barren life. Nothing new props up in my life. I'm not happy anymore. I don't feel the joy of being committed to the Lord. Barren life. Busy life is a barren life. If that busy life is not offered to God, it will remain a desert. My heart will remain a desert. It is said of Pope, Saint Pope John Paul II. This is given to us by his secretary, now Cardinal Stanislaus of Krakow. When the Pope prayed in the chapel, his secretary would be sitting behind, because when the Pope prayed, he did not want to be disturbed. And that's when the Cardinal Secretary of State came rushing, telling the secretary, at that time, Monsignor Stanislaus, Monsignor, I want to speak to the Holy Father. The Monsignor told Cardinal Secretary of State, Your Eminence, His Holiness is praying. He does not want to be disturbed. And Cardinal Secretary of State is number two in Vatican. A very prominent person. It is he who wants to speak to the Pope. And he said to Monsignor, Monsignor, understand me. This is a matter of urgency. I have to speak to the Holy Father. So, the Monsignor Stanislaus went to the Holy Father, Pope John Paul II, and told him, Your Holiness, His Eminence, Cardinal Secretary of State, wants to talk to you very urgently. And the Pope smiled and asked, Monsignor, did the Cardinal say it's a very urgent matter? Yes, Your Holiness, that's why I'm disturbing you now. And Pope John Paul II smiled and said, tell His Eminence, the Cardinal, if the matter is so urgent, I need to pray a little more. We make urgent decisions according to the circumstances, not according to the will of God. I do not pray and wait before God before making a decision. When Jesus was concerned about the others, Luke chapter 22 verse 31, telling Simon Peter, Simon, the devil is after you. I have prayed for you. Luke chapter 9 verse 18, feeling alone with the Father. Well, the Gospels are full of a picture of Jesus in prayer. And today, we want to ask the Lord, Lord, teach us to pray with the Spirit. I may be able to join the Holy Spirit within me, praying. A Hindu sannyasin of Kerala. He was an engineer in the secular world, a very efficient engineer. He has written his autobiography in a few articles. And he writes, I wanted to join the Ramakrishna mission to experience God. I understand the secular world is fleeting and passing. I want to be a man of prayer. So he joined. Everybody dissuaded him, but he joined. People asked him, where do you want to go? You are educated. You have a prosperous future. Why do you want to go run into the monastery? He said, understand, my life is the life of being one with God. And he was trained in the Ramakrishna Mission Ashram in Calcutta. And I'm cutting it short. He was appointed as a teacher in a Ramakrishna Mission school in Shillong. To cut a long story short, after a few years, he leaves the monastery, falls in love with a small girl, his student, runs away from Shillong and comes here. He died 2 years ago. Now, he's evaluating himself at the end of his life. Where did I fail? He said, I failed because I thought I was a machine. Ramakrishna Mission is a machine. Having many activities, schools, clinics, orphanages, and many other institutions. And I was just a spare part, moving. I will get up in the morning, I will meditate, I will take breakfast, I go to the school, I teach, I come back, wash myself, pray, and sleep. A machine, mechanical movement. Mechanical movement has no life, has it? I was feeling bored up with this mechanical life, routine life. And that's when a girl, a Kasi girl, his student, looked at him and smiled. And he said, I felt a very cool sensation in my heart, a sensation I never felt in prayer for a long time. I began to think of her all the time. The next day also, she came and said, sir, good morning. He also said, good morning. And then, if a day she did not come to greet him, he felt empty. He said, all my delight of life is in that smile of that girl. No delight in prayer. And that's what he thought. He would get that delight as the goal of his life, and he ran away with her. And he continues, I made a big mistake. My life is a failure because I thought Ramakrishna Mission was a big machine. I was only a spare part in it. I'm not a necessary spare part. If I go away, they will replace that spare part, that position of a teacher in that school. I'm not necessary for Ramakrishna Mission, for that school. But I was necessary for God. He called me into monastery to be united with him. I forgot about it. I should have thought of myself as a branch of a big tree. Branch connected, united with the main stem, getting all the delight, all the energy, all the joy, all the power from the main stem. I did not do that. I failed in my search. You know, my dear sisters, your convent, your congregation, how do you look at it? How do you look at yourself? Just a spare part? Mechanical movement? Are you connected? Know one thing. If you die today, you will not. But if you die today, your position will be replaced by someone else. And your name will be the last one in the obituary list of your convent, of your congregation. Your sisters will pray for you once a year. Who are you necessary for? Who are you important for? The one who called you, the one who considered you precious and dear. He's telling you, abide in me. I will abide in you. The most beautiful, delightful moment of our life should be the moment I'm connected with my God in prayer. John chapter 19, verses 34 to 37, we are told, the heart of Jesus was pierced open. John says, I'm a witness. Blood and water flowed down. And then John writes, quoting Zechariah, Prophet Zechariah, why was the heart of Jesus pierced open? That we may look at him. We may look at him. That's what Eucharistic adoration is, looking at Jesus, who offered his heart to be pierced for me. For me. When I look into that heart, I would know that heart is never closed against me. Always open for me at every moment. Even when I commit a sin, that heart is still open for me, throbbing in love for me. When I look into that heart, I would experience joy welling up in my heart. The joy of the Holy Spirit. You know, scientists will tell us there are genes in a child, genes of a father, genes of a mother. Say, for example, in the son or daughter of a poet, there will be genes of poetry. Of an artist, there will be paint in the genes of his son, her daughter. In us, there are genes, spiritual genes. What are these spiritual genes? The fruits of the Holy Spirit. Galatians chapter 5, verses 22, 23. Love, peace, and joy, and patience, and kindness, and goodness, and gentleness, and self-control. These are powers, spiritual genes. The genes will be activated in me when I look into the heart of Jesus. Into the heart of Jesus, find time to be with the Lord. To look into the open heart of Jesus. Praying with Mother Mary, simple prayer, rosary, but a prayer of depth of love. It is said on January 15, 2009, there was accident in the air in New York, and the pilot who was in charge of that plane was Chesley Sullenberger. He writes, this flight US Airways 1549, flight 1549 up in the air, the plane took off. Up in the air, the pilot realized bird came and struck, hit the airplane. As a result, both the engines were disabled by the hit of the bird. And there were 155 passengers in the flight. The pilot says, I did not know what to do. Both the engines failed. It's going to be a catastrophe. I became blank. And that's when he said, I felt my heart was praying, Hail Mary, full of grace. The Lord is with you. The prayer my mother taught me as a child. I could feel my mother close to me, Mother Mary close to me. My heart was raised up to that love. I was illumined. I felt a great light coming upon me. I looked down. the broad, long Hudson River. And he said, in that light, I knew what to do. He slowly lowered the plane to the river, and the plane perched on the water. No one was hurt. I prayed the prayer my mother taught me, simplicity of prayer in the love of the Holy Spirit. My dear sisters, let us find our prayer, the delight of our life. Oh God, teach us to pray. You have called us to be with you, to be available to you, to be sent out on a mission. Lord, I'm not always available to you because I'm not with you. Teach me to be with you in prayer. Amen. My dear sisters, in a few moments' time, we will proceed to the Eucharistic Adoration.
Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My dear sisters, as we prepare ourselves for the Holy Eucharistic Adoration, let us all completely offer ourselves, all that we are and all that we have, giving thanks for all the blessings that He has poured out into our lives. And we sing together this beautiful hymn from our hearts.
Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because it's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because it's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Because of what the Lord has done for us. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich. Because of what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks.
we prepare ourselves, this time, let us all give our heart to Jesus. As a sign of our surrender, let us all, with all our heart, give thanks to our God.
Of his glory and grace.
You may take a comfortable, honorable posture in the presence of the Lord. The Lord is here. He's come to us in the form of bread. The form He wanted to take to remain with us always. He loved His own. He loved them to the end. And here it is, manifested to us. A majestic God, glorious God, He did not think it was necessary to hold on to His heavenly glory. He came down as a little babe in the lap of Mother Mary in Bethlehem. He went about saving, healing, proclaiming the love of the Abba. It is time for Him to offer that body on the cross. But He wanted to remain with us forever in a visible form. And He took bread in the Last Supper and said, "This is my body to be broken for you." That body you will see broken on the cross, this is that body, Jesus, becomes so small as a piece of bread to tell you and me how much He loves, how much He cares. He would never abandon us. He would remain visible and tangible. At every moment of our life, let us look into His eyes. Eyes that look at us. He's inviting us, "Abide in me. Remain with me." Let us remain close to the Lord, to feel the power of His love gripping us, filling us, and transforming us. And that's what everyone felt. Everyone who chose to come to Him felt the warmth of love, the power of compassion, the warmth that made their lives warm
with love. They were not the same anymore. Like a piece of iron coming close to a powerful magnet, the piece of iron feels the power gripping it. Every bit of the piece of iron gripped by that power, the iron turns to a magnet. Lord, that is what we want. That is what you came for, to fill us, to transform us. Martha said to Mary in Bethany, "The Lord is here asking for you." Mary was sitting in the house shedding tears. Martha went to receive Jesus. He came late, 4 days over after the death of Lazarus, their brother. And Martha went to Mary and said, "The Lord is here asking for you." My sister, the Lord is here asking for you. He knows how sad you are. He knows how empty you are. He knows how tired you are. He knows how anxious you are. He knows the many failures that embarrassed you, the many moments of unfaithfulness that haunt you. He knows the tears in your heart. He's asking for you, to tell you one thing, how much he loves, how precious you are to him. Listen to this word the Lord is telling you now.
"I have called you by your name. In my palms I've engraved you. You're mine, I won't forsake you. You're precious and I love you. You're mine, forsake you. You're precious and I love you."
You felt belittled, embarrassed, belittled by your companions, embarrassed by your failures. He felt irritated by the neglect of your superiors. You felt very unhappy with yourself. You are not able to pray at all. The Lord is here asking for you, to tell you how precious you are, how dear you are to his heart.
"No sorrow will overwhelm you. No evil will you fear. And flames will not consume you when you walk your name. In my palms I've engraved you. You're mine, I won't forsake you. You're precious and I love you.
Over the years, in religious life, in community living, you began to look at yourself as others looked at you. You began to evaluate yourself as others remarked about you. Negative comments, hurting experiences, embarrassing behavior patterns, you thought you were good for nothing. You even thought you made a mistake to come into the sanctuary of religious life. You even thought of an escape. My sister, you need to look at yourself as the Lord looks at you. Your identity is what the Lord has given you in the context of an intimate relationship with Him. The Lord is telling you how precious you are to Him.
No mother can forget her child. By the bond that binds their love. But even if this love must die, I will never forget you. I will never forget you. I have called you by your name. In my palms I've engraved you. You're mine, I won't forsake you. You're precious and I love you. You're mine, I won't forsake you. You're precious and I love you.
John, the son of Zebedee, a young fisherman, was called by Jesus. Even while walking with Jesus, he was tormented by impulsive anger, arrogance, and revenge. He wanted fire and brimstone to come down and destroy a village when the villagers did not welcome Jesus. He was a man dominated by youthful ambitions for power and position. But during the Last Supper, when Judas, remained far away from the Master, John chose to sit close to him, lean his head on the side of Jesus, to feel that heart throb. And his heart began to throb in the same rhythm of love that the heart of the Master was beating. He became the beloved disciple. My sister, you could be disturbed by the wrong things happening to you, finding yourself a burden, out of place in religious life. Sit close to the Lord. What happened to John, the disciple, is happening to you now. The magnet of love is gripping you, changing you, making you a new creation. Just offer to him everything. Every negative feeling, every sad thing that happened to you, everything that dominates your heart, everything unwanted, surrender it to the Lord. Your heart will beat in the same rhythm. All the molecules of your heart, like in a piece of iron, all the molecules of your heart will fall in line with that rhythm of love. Let it be a moment of truth for you, a moment of surrender. Offer it all to the Lord. His love is flowing out of his heart. His heart is open, never closed against you. Always he has been asking for you. And today, the Lord is telling you,
I have called you by your name. In my palm I engraved you.
Your precious hand,
I've seen you in your mother's womb. In my arms you grew. Fear not the darkest night. In my arms I hide you. In my arms I hide you. I have called you by your name. In my palms I've engraved you. You're mine, I won't forsake you. You're precious and I love you. You're mine, I won't forsake you. You're precious and I love 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 you.
Nicodemus, Gospel of John, chapter 3, verses 1 onwards. Nicodemus, a man of leadership in the Jewish community, a scholar of the law, a teacher of the people. And yet, he did not know how to enter the kingdom of God. He did not feel the grip of the kingdom of God. He did not know the depth of God's love and peace and joy. And so he had an emptiness, a disturbing emptiness in his heart, a dryness in his life. He came to Jesus at night in the first watch of the night. During the day, the master is busy with the people. He wanted some time, quiet time with the Lord. And Jesus spoke to him about the necessity of being reborn, becoming a new creation in the Holy Spirit. And the Lord ushered him into the kingdom of God. He felt that change. He felt that change so deeply in his heart. The emptiness of his heart was so filled with the love of God in the nearness of the Master. In John chapter 7, he becomes so strong to argue for Jesus in the Sanhedrin, in the highest council of the Jews. He was rooted in Christ. So rooted in Christ, he did not care to please anyone. And he became so bold on Calvary when all the acknowledged apostles had run away. It was Nicodemus who came with Joseph of Arimathea to take the dead body of Jesus down and lay it in the lap of Mother Mary. And later, being taken for burial, became bold. He became connected to Jesus. My sister, how bold are you in your commitment, surrender to the Lord? When temptations came your way, could you tell Satan, as Jesus said, "Get behind me, Satan, I belong to my Jesus. I will not entertain any thought of anger, any unclean thought, any thought of power and possession, any hurt feeling in my heart." Lord, in your presence, I need that transformation. John chapter 4, the Samaritan woman. A woman thirsty for love, unsettled life, going after men, to quench her thirst. Thirsting for appreciation, thirsting to be accepted, to be loved, and became all the more thirsty. In the presence of Jesus, this wasted life became precious. When the Lord filled her with the living waters of the Holy Spirit, she became a missionary to proclaim that Jesus is the Savior of the world. My sister, do you feel your life is wasted? Shopping for love, reaching hands out for appreciation, again and again rejected, having achieved nothing. What have I gained in my religious life? When others occupy high positions and big chairs, my chair is still down below. A sense of failure. And powers of sin bombarding you with all sorts of thoughts, unholy desires, unwanted. Let the Holy Spirit search your heart and let it all flow into the heart of Jesus, the open heart of Jesus. Zacchaeus, in the presence of Jesus, he was gripped by the power of the love of the magnet of Jesus. He felt forces of sin, chains of evil breaking down. All the ambitious thoughts and desires, all the addictions of evil, all cast out . He felt that freedom in front of Jesus, a freedom the Lord is giving you now, my sister. For my property, he said, I just give it all to the poor, and if I've cheated anyone, I go to them. I give back fourfold. My sister, who is Jesus sending you to? Someone you hurt? Someone who hurt you? If you spoiled any name, good reputation of anyone, the Lord could be sending you to them to restore fourfold. That is the miracle of love. What the Lord is doing to you now. Simon Peter. Jesus turned and looked at him. He was so hard-hearted, become hard because of shame and guilt for having denied Jesus. He was sitting, turning the other way, turning away from Jesus. Jesus, early morning, being taken out for the trial, Jesus turned and looked at him. And all the hardness of heart, heart made hard because of shame and guilt, all that hardness melted away. Tears falling down, tears of repentance. What have you to repent about? Have you repented about denying Jesus? Look at Jesus. His eyes are looking at you. I do not condemn you. Go in peace.
For me,
fields, they're white unto harvest. But oh, the laborers are so few. So Lord, I give myself to help the reaping, to gather precious souls unto you. Here I am, holy available. As for me, I will serve the of power and authority. God's looking for a people who are willing to be counted in His glorious victory. Here I am, holy
myself. I see a bundle of negative emotions, a bundle of unholy passions, a bundle of negativities. Lord, when you look at me, you see a rock. For you to build your church, you look at me as a missionary, able to be sent with a mission of love, with a message of salvation. Here I am. Jesus, bless me. Your blessing will work wonders in my heart, in my life. I worship you, O Lord.
Dear sisters, this evening, find some time, early hours of the night, find time to be with the Lord, because the Lord is asking for you. Find time to be with the Lord. Tomorrow morning we begin at 6:30 with the morning worship, 7:15 the Holy Mass, 10 o'clock the talk, afternoon 3 o'clock the Divine Mercy Adoration, and 5:30 again the talk and the Eucharistic Adoration. Pray for everyone in different parts of the world. We're all united in the presence of our God. Space does not separate us. All of us are united by the word and love of our God. Let's pray for everyone.